or certain decisions of not burying family members because they committed suicide. We believe all these decisions are harmful to individuals because they affect them negatively on a psychological level. They bring psychological uncomfortable situations. So thank you, madam. And the third criteria is the one in which churches make decisions that harm and damage the right to choice and the right to pursuit of happiness of their members. For example, Islamic churches, mosques that deny their members the right to go to university, that deny young girls the right to go to university and follow a higher education decided by these mosques. Now, upon the idea of suing a certain religious organization, we see that we mean by this that individuals will be able to take that religious organization to court. Like any other judicial process, it will be governed by the same laws. These religious organizations will be represented through their officials, through their clerics, or through their episcopies, and so on. No, thank you, madam. Now, having dealt with definitions and all, let's go into my first point upon our first argument. Upon the nature of decisions made by religious organizations. And we see that in the current status quo, these individuals are especially vulnerable to this type of harmful decisions made by these churches. Why is that? We have 3 points to make here upon why they are very vulnerable. First of all, these people are extremely vulnerable today to these decisions because they very powerfully believe in the higher authority they make part of in that congregation. They have a very high relationship with that kind of church. They have a very personal and intimate relationship to which they constantly relate to. Now, what happens in this context is these individuals are very vulnerable to this harm because the churches always relate those harms to a higher power in which the individual is necessarily, I'll take you a moment, is necessarily made to believe in. Even if it harms them, it makes them extremely vulnerable because they cannot respond to this higher power.
If a priest rapes or molests one boy, would you assume the entire Catholic Church?
Two things. First of all, we would first of all believe that that family can sue only that priest in himself if he is the one only responsible for the rape. We believe he should be sued as an individual. But we also believe there are certain decisions that are intrinsic to a whole church, to a whole dogma, such as banning abortion, for example, such as not allowing young girls to go to university in Islam. No, thank you, madam. And if it is discovered that the church covered up for that certain priest that raped a certain child, we believe then it would be reasonable for that person to sue the church because it covered up and it came on an institutional position upon that rape to cover it up. Now going on to my first argument. Moreover, we tell you that these people are especially vulnerable in today's society to these decisions because they cannot contest them in the current status quo. They have no way of filing petitions or complaints or any kind of formal or official contesting of a certain decisions. Moreover, there is no dialogue. No, thank you. There is no dialogue between these religious institutions and these members once they take a decision. These religious institutions did not offer pro and con arguments for banning abortion or banning vaccines or any kind of harmful decisions. You cannot reason with them because they base their decision on a higher authority. Moreover, we tell you that most of the times you cannot opt out from that religious authority because first of all, you might be born in that religion and shaped of it, and second of all, it is extremely damaging on a psychological level to opt out of it. We see that this makes up for very vulnerable individuals, and we believe this motion will give them the power to contest these kind of harms and decisions and not be vulnerable. Into my second point, on the legal status of the church and how it's unjust to be a preferential one. So today, Team Proposition tells you today that first of all, organized religions should be a representative forum for their congregation. They should be representative because those people chose to be of their religion, chose to identify with that religion, and have chosen to align their behavior and attitude and traits to that religion. But we tell you that since they should be a representative's power, they should also be an accountable power. They should also be accountable to their congregation and to respond to their unwill. We believe that the relationship should go in the both directions, still from the higher authority of God and of priests to the congregation, but from the congregation to the higher authority too, and it should be regulated both ways, making it accountable. We see that if any other private company in the world today would take the kind of decision such as churches do. For example, not letting a person to go to university or banning blood transplants or vaccines. We would clearly be able to sue them in today's world and probably win for that if it were a private company. We believe the same standards should be applied for churches because they shouldn't have a preferential position in our society from which they can easily harm its members. Thank you.
All right, we are ready to hear from the first opposition speaker.
Representative of this entire religion. Okay, so our team stands here is today that we think that you should have the ability to sue one individual within any religious organization if they have in any way done any illegal act. But since we do not believe that one individual is representative of an entire religious organization, thank you, they should be held accountable for this individual's actions. So firstly, we tell you that we very much appreciated when the first proposition speaker spends 4 minutes on building up a model. But we also say that many of the things he said within his model aren't actually true. We are saying that many religions have different aspects, such as, for instance, taking the religion of Islam. He said that in Islam, no girl should ever be allowed to go to school. No girl should be allowed to go to university. We're telling you, this is a fragment of Islam, whereas other sides say, oh, you know what, we should actually have girls going to school. This is why we also see Muslim girls, no thank you, being in school. We're saying this is a direct mischaracterization we have heard from the team proposition today, and that's why we're ultimately going to take this debate. So also, moving into his first point, which is how people are so vulnerable because they believe so strongly in this religion. And we're telling you that one, people are rational. People have the ability to see, rights and wrongs of this religion, and can then hence choose whether they want to be a part of it or not. We're saying that if they do not want to be, if they are manipulated so strongly into being a part of it, it's still their responsibility. I'm going to get into that in my second argument. So two, we heard this entire way, you have no idea, no way of going against this entire religion because you cannot sign a petition. We're saying that the religion, you always have the choice of opting out of it. We're not saying that the religion keeps you locked in some sort of room and has thrown away the key. We're saying that's wrong. Then we also heard this entire idea that churches should always be held accountable. We're saying, no, churches should not be held accountable. It should be the individuals that are committing these crimes within these organizations saying that, thank you. That is what, so now let me get into my argument, because today team opposition brings with 3 arguments. One, how this entire resolution is ineffective. Two, why this violates freedom of, how we actually protect the freedom of choice. And three, my second speaker will come up here and talk to you about the immense backlash we will have if we go through with this motion. So let's get into the whole entire argument about ineffectiveness. And here we're really talking about, like, how do you prove that something's being harmful to you? How do you prove that if, for instance, through Scientology, you have been brainwashed? Because we're saying that what if this decision is actually very, very, very hard to determine. What if you just had a change of opinion? I know that Alberta on my team used to be very liberal, then she got into the entire idea of the socialistic opinions, and then she was like, you know what, I'm going to have a change of heart. In this way, that she was Even though she had been a part of multiple liberal party organizations, she decided to change her opinion. We're saying that she had, even though she believed very strongly in this ideology, people can change. And when they do so, they have a rational idea of going out. No, thank you. Also, we were saying that if you can prove that this direct harm is being done to you, this direct harm, such as abuse, then we say that you should be able to sue this one individual who has committed these crimes. So, then moving on to my second subpoint in this, which is how one individual isn't representative of an entire religion. And here I think I already dealt with authority in my model paper, how there is in one religion not like one standard belief. We're saying you that even though that some people within a religion might ban vaccination, we're not saying that this is the case with the entire religion. We're saying to no, thank you. We're also saying that even if you believe that this is so harmful when the Catholic Church doesn't want abortions, then we're saying that you have the opportunity to decide, you know what, I actually want to go on abortion, so I'm not going to follow through with this religion. We also need to hear from them how just suing a religion is going to change an entire religion's perspective. No, thank you. It's going to change the entire belief of one religion, because we do not believe it's very beneficial when you just go in there and say, you know what, I believe everything you do here is wrong. And my second speaker will come up here and talk to you about the potential backlash that this can have. So before I move on, yes, I'll take your
opinion. Madam, you're misportraying it. It's not about suing an entire religion, not suing Islam. It's about suing a certain religious organization, a certain church, or a certain local religion of power, for example.
Yeah, but we're still saying that all these harms still stand, because we want to sue the one individual who went in there harmed you. We want to sue the one individual who gave you, who somehow abused you, who somehow brainwashed you. That's what we're saying. That's the one individual you should go for, because he's not representative of the entire religion. And we're saying even as if this entire religion went in and actually had crimes on multiple levels, such as, for instance, honor killings, then we also don't think that this should be the responsibility of the individuals who go in and sue. Now, why is this? Well, we're saying that these religions have a lot of power. We're saying that they have a lot of they have a lot of people who are supporting them, and we hence believe that it should be the state who actively goes in and say, you're doing something illegal, we want to stop this. So, in the case of banning abortions, we're saying that the state has the ultimate choice of whether this should be banned or not. We're saying that the state is the high power that allows them, thank you, for this to be legal or not. We're saying that the state also has the responsibility to make sure that these organizations don't commit honor killings, which we all know is illegal. So to ensure that this does not happen, we say that the state is a better suitor for going in when these actually violate freedom. Right? But when it's only an individual, one individual who tells you, oh, you know what, girls should go to school, then he's the one who should be held accountable for giving this sort of choice. No, thank you. So moving into my second argument, which is really this entire idea of freedom of choice. So we're telling you that you made a rational decision to join these religions. And here we have two scenarios. So the first scenario, which he tried to paint, is like, you didn't really make this rational decision, you really just grew up in it. Well, we are saying that if you grew up in it, then there's multiple people that you have to hold accountable for. It's the environment in which you grew up in. It's the fact that your entire family used to be Catholic. And we are saying that it's these families and friends as well. They should then also be held accountable. How are you going to do that? We're saying that if you should be so scared of going away from this religion, then you're also ultimately going to lose your friends and family. And we're hence saying that scenario one, you cannot hold anyone accountable. That's also what they have to prove today, how it's going to make everything better. So in the second scenario, we're saying that even if you are rational, even if you make this rational choice to join the decision, then that's even better. Because then you also can make the rational decision of going out. We're saying that when you chose to join the religion, you opted the entire cost-benefit analysis, pros versus cons. And we're saying that you had an interest in actually staying in this religion. We're saying that if you had been locked up in some individual priest cellar, then yes, that would be problematic. Then yes, you could be able to sue that one individual priest. But since that's not the case, since you can make the rational decision to leave, then you should ultimately do it. We're saying that the state is a greater manner of which presents you what you can do and what you cannot do. We're ultimately telling you that when one individual from one religion goes in and harms you, we're saying that this is an individual that should be sued. Ultimately, that's the case that we bring it forward today, because we do not believe that every single religious institution is either black or white. We don't believe that every single priest molests children, and that's why we ultimately stand so proud to oppose today's motion.
All right, we are now ready to hear from the second proposition speaker.
Christian and I live in Africa. The church in my village decides not to give out any form of contraception because they tell me it's against God. Now, I contact sexually transmitted diseases like AIDS. Imagine I'm a Muslim and I live in Saudi Arabia. The church in my town decides that women shouldn't go to school because God tells us that women are housewives. Now, this affects my education, and forever I'm banned, I'm obliged to stand without education. Imagine I live in France and I'm Christian. I desperately need a heart transplant, but the church in my town tells me that God is against it, that it is sin. That affects my health, and that can be proven. These are the types of harms that affect people, and that people should have control over by suing these religious institutions that make them. In my extension today, I will be telling you why this is an incentive for churches and religious institutions to finally adapt to modern times, and be more modern in terms of their decision, and abandon the conservative decisions that they currently make. But before that, I have mentioned, thank you madam, I have 4 points of rebuttal. First of all, regarding the burden that deemed opposition has been placing upon us and what they think we should be doing in terms of abuses and harms. First of all, they've been telling us that not all individuals are responsible for these harms that we have talked about. We never said that we will sue all people that are Islam or all people that are religious or all people that belong to that institution. We are not going to sue Christianity or Islam. We are going to sue that particular church in that particular occasion that made that particular decision. No, thank you. These religious institutions are represented. These religious institutions should act like companies, like any other institutions in the status quo that we currently sue. Now, then they have been telling us that, well, we should sue that one individual who harmed you. Now we have two responses to this. First of all, in some cases, it is not only the individual that is responsible for it. They have asked us in appeal, why don't you sue that priest that raped you or sexually abused you? The difference between that act and banning contraception is that in the case in which individuals sexually abuse people, that is a case of an individual responsibility, an individual criminal liability that you have. While when the church or the religion organizations make decisions such as banning contraception, then that is a decision made by the whole organization that should be held accountable. Sometimes we are not talking about individual guilt, but collective guilt. So that's why we need to take legal action against collective guilt. The second point deals with the nature of this decision. Tudor has explained how religion is deeply important for people because it's not about right or wrong. It's not about bringing arguments, pros and cons. It's about believing in something. To which the opposition has replied that people are rational. They can know what's right and what's wrong. They can choose for themselves if they believe in what the church tells them. False. This is the whole problem with religion. It is not a very rational process. You are emotionally attached to the divine authority that you believe in. When they tell me that God says it's a sin for you to have vaccination, that I'm not going to be thinking in terms of pros and cons, I'm going to be thinking in terms of my emotional connection to what my God tells me. No, thank you. And this is precisely why I'm vulnerable, and I tend to believe in these things, and I have no leverage whatsoever in terms of my relationship with the religious institution. No, thank you. They've been telling us, well, you can opt out. You shouldn't have to opt out of that church simply because they make decisions that harm you. You should be able to be Christian and protest against some things that are not related to Christianity. You should be able to still be part of that religion without having to face the consequences of this decision. So that's why we believe that instead of opting out, what you should do is protest by suing the religion organization. Thank you, madam. The third point of rebuttal deals with the fact that allegedly you cannot prove the harm that has been done. Well, that just shows us that they haven't listened to our model. Because first of all, the physical harms that you experience because of these decisions can be proven. The fact that I cannot have an abortion is something that can be proven. The fact that I contact sexually transmitted diseases because you don't give me access to contraception can be proven. No, thank you, medically so. But second of all, we also tell you that in the status quo, in the current system in which the juridical process works, you can even prove psychological damage. The whole point of awarding financial compensation, financial damage, for example, verbal assault, is the fact that people can claim that they have been psychologically disturbed by some actions. If somebody calls me something on the street, I can prove in court that that affected, no, thank you, my psychological integrity, and I can be awarded damages for it. The fourth point of rebuttal, and the final one, deals with the fact that states are responsible, according to the opposition, states are responsible for adopting laws. They've been telling us that states are responsible for all of these things like banning abortion. Two responses. First of all, we believe that in some cases, the pressure from the church is extremely important. Putting pressure on states to adopt laws as a religious institution is just as important and as severe as a consequence as adopting them yourself. But second of all, we believe that some of these harms are not legally enforced, but are decisions made by organizations that still harm individuals. For example, by telling people that women shouldn't go to school or that vaccination is a sin, you don't have to legally enforce it, but you are still responsible and thank you as a religious institution for them. Before I go on to the plan, yes.
Okay, but isn't that ultimate flaw in your case when you say that people are so into their religion that they're never going to make the rational decision of opting out, but will make the rational decision of suing the organization?
There's a difference between suing the organization and opting out. I can still believe in the values of Christianity, yet I cannot agree with some decisions made by some Christian organizations. Now going on to constructive, right? We believe that our model will incentivize these religion institutions to adopt things and to adapt to present time and be more modern in terms of their views. Now all of the harms that Tudor has presented to you today are harms that are harms that arise from decisions that are very conservative. For example, not allowing people to use condoms is a very conservative view regarding sexual intercourse. Not allowing women to have abortion is something that's very conservative. In modern times, these things have evolved. In modern times, most states with liberal views accept that we cannot play by the same doctrine used in the past. In modern times, we accept that having the vaccination is not a sign that you have adopted your belief in God, that heart transplant is something that is not against the will of the divinity, and so forth. Now, what we believe in today's debate is that if you allow individuals to sue organizations for these decisions, you will incentivize them not to adopt these decisions that are highly conservative. You will allow this. You will make these institutions be more adopt more to the current status quo. We believe that this is precisely what happened in Dublin a while ago. Women protested in the street against the church's decision to ban abortion. Young girls took the streets to tell the world that we do not agree anymore with the practice of banning abortion and being against it. Why? Because these women represent a coming generation in which women should have the freedom to allow for themselves what they believe in. And when you have been harmed, your physical or psychological integrity has been harmed by the religion institution that is supposed to protect you and represent you, then you have every right to sue them in court for the damage that has been created. Because we believe that people should have leverage over religion institutions, because we believe that people should have the right to protest against something that has been harmful to them, I beg of you to propose.
All right. Now we will hear from the second opposition speaker.
Mr. Speaker, when do we sue people? When has a crime been done? A crime has been done when a harm has been imposed on you without your consent. And that is essentially what Proposition had to prove to you in today's debate. Why exactly it is that these people don't consent to being in the religion they are today. But ladies and gentlemen, Proposition have failed to fulfill their burden of today's debate. Let me tell you why. Firstly, we already told you if they make a rational choice of joining a religion, right? And secondly, we told you like if they grow up in these environments, and they join these religions, right? It's not due to the religion itself, but it's due to the environment they grew up in. That's why we can't sue the religion organization, but the whole environment, which we don't think is feasible. But thirdly, we told you that they can opt out in the first place, right? It's not necessarily because you have to stay in your religion. And we think that if you actually don't like the things that are in your religion, you may not be that religious. But we say even if you are, no thank you. We say even if you are, but you don't want to live up to all the requirements, that's totally fine. We say that in most cases, you don't have to live up to all the requirements, right? You don't necessarily have to consent to all the requirements, right? You can still be like a good Christian without living up to all the requirements. They never explain to us why exactly it is they have to do all of the requirements. Now ladies and gentlemen, before going to our third and final argument about the backlash and how they're going to worsen the situation overall, let me just go into some rebuttal and reconstruction. Now in the intro, the second speaker from the proposition team talked about how in Africa and in Saudi Arabia, you don't really have a choice. Let me explain why it's ineffective in the first place, their motion. Firstly, in these countries, those who are in power are those who are conservative, who are religious. Look at Saudi Arabia, their government. Look at Iran, their government, right? They take a clear stance within the religion. So if someone suddenly goes out and says, you know what, I don't like the requirements within Islam, it's not going to happen anything. Because the courts is an extension of the government, which takes a clear stance of the religion. That means that the one pursuing the religious organization isn't really going to benefit from it, because the government is only going to crack down on it, right? But furthermore, we tell you over and over again that you should sue the individual, and even if that it was not the whole organization as a whole we should sue, it's the state's responsibility. Now ladies and gentlemen, what did we bring forth in today's debate? Let's reconstruct Clara's points. Firstly, we gave you the first point about how it's ineffective, right? We talked about that the state should be able to sue. Now they gave us this response that laws are not legally enforced, right? But firstly, we say that you can still sue from the state and still sue, right? But secondly, we say that if the state is not suing as a whole, but the individual is suing the whole organization, all the other ones from the religion is not benefit from it. If the state is suing and changing the laws, we think that they can have consequences for the religions if they don't adhere to those laws in the first place. If the individuals sue the organization, on the other hand, which is what they're advocating for, right, it's not going to benefit all the other ones who also want to benefit from it. But furthermore, Clara talked to you about why it's ineffective and why these religious institutions have the money in the first place to crack down on these individuals who are suing them. They never really responded to this, right? We already explained to you, in those conservative states, those who are in power, the government, they're not going to say, you know what, you know, it's okay, you don't you fulfill the requirements, no thank you. Furthermore, our second argument was this. So basically we think that you have a freedom of choice, saying firstly, if you are rational in the first place, right, and you go into these religions, right, if you can, consider the pros and cons, right, that's a rational choice. But secondly, we say even if you are being grown up in this environment, right, we should also, according to them, sue all of the family and friends, because they are also impacting you and apparently brainwashing you, right? So what did they tell you today's debate? Firstly, they came up with this point about nature and decision of religion, right? They told you that people are vulnerable and so on. Clara told you that firstly, you can opt out, and secondly, right, if you really want abortion, right, religion, don't necessarily have to be in religion or fulfill all of the requirements, right? They talked to us that you shouldn't have to opt out. No, but you don't have to fulfill all the requirements in the first place, right? And we say that even if you want to change religion, right, there's this state where more beneficial in suing the religious institutions in the first place, because they have won the money, and secondly, because the individuals don't change the laws for all the other ones, but the state can do so. Before I move on, go.
What happens if I'm gay and the church decides to excommunicate me because of it? That harms me. Who should I sue?
You should sue the individual who does that. But even if we say you don't sue the individual, we think it's the state's responsibility in the first place to sue the whole religion if that proves harm to all of the society, right? So basically, that didn't really respond to Clara's points. Now let's go briefly into their model and look at why it's so ineffective, why their model is so ineffective in today's debate. Firstly, they talked about how it's like the whole organization, not the religion itself, where you're like assumed, right? We say that the religious organization is basically an extension of that religion. That means when you're suing an organization, that also means you're suing the religion. Right. Secondly, they talked about the three different harms that like can be imposed to the individual. Firstly, that is going to affect the like physical harms. So within like one, you can sue the individual if you're being molested. They said that's okay. They said, yeah, we agree. But secondly, we secondly you can like opt out. If I find out like I really want an abortion, I can like opt out of that religion because of that. Also because if I like get an abortion anyways, everybody else in my religion is going to look down upon me, right? And we think that that's not an incentive for someone to get an abortion even if it was legalized, right? No, thank you. But thirdly, we think it's only going to be worse than under their model, right? And I'm going to explain to you why in my third point, right? Then they talk about like their psychological well-being, right? Two responses. Firstly, we're already proven to you why it's like the freedom of choice. But secondly, we tell you that it's hard to prove. Now they try to make it out like it's, and seem like it's really, really easy to prove psychological harms. But we say even if it's really easy to prove the psychological harms, it's not easy to prove where they come from. Meaning, is it from the religious institutions, or is it like the family? We don't really know. They talked about like the harms of pursuit of happiness. We think that's ridiculous. I can't like do a lot of things. I'm not like suing my parents and stuff like that, right? So ladies and gentlemen, we're gonna go into the third and final point, right? Let's go into the point of backlash. Our thesis is this. Suing the whole organization legitimizes the religion as a whole, because one, let's talk about brainwash. It tells that the whole religion is wrong just when you also say that the state is actively promoting atheism, right? Saying that the whole organization, whole religion is wrong. But secondly, in cases of psychological harms, you tell that the whole religion is like that. That the whole religion is trying to like physical harm you, right? So we're saying even if it's true that the whole organization is harming you, we think it's the state's responsibility to take care of it, because the state is supposed to like take care of the people, protect the people, right? So what are the harms? One, religion is going to be like the religions are going to be more isolated, right? But secondly, we're going to distance the religious people even further from society. That means that even if they're brainwashed, we're not doing it worse because they feel betrayed from society, right? We think that we are preventing that under our model. Thank you.
Now we will hear from the third proposition speaker.
It's high time we stop believing that just because they say that they preach the word of God, everything religious organizations do is right. It's high time we stop being not able to defend ourselves in the face of abuse, of harms that are both physical and psychological. In my speech today, I'm firstly going to tackle a few of the points brought out in my second opposition and the misportrayal of this individual belonging to the religious organizations. Then I'm going to talk about opting out, which is their parallel plan and their solution, and I'm going to explain why it isn't justified or viable. And secondly, I'm going to talk about religious versus the practices of religious organizations. So first of all, a few points of rebuttal. They've told us that the courts of justice in most countries won't do anything because they're also religiously affiliated. False. Most countries embrace a system that separates the church from the state, that separates governments and parliaments that have laws and courts of justice that are going to, no thank you, evaluate these claims from religious organizations. It's just a speculation, and it's factually inaccurate to say that these claims aren't going to be judged properly because, well, the judge is also a Christian or a Muslim. That never happens. That's not how the judicial system works. Secondly, they told us that, no thank you, that this kind of going to court it will be ineffective because the church is going to be able to crack down on you and they reduce you to silence. Well, that's the kind of power we want to, no thank you, take away from religious organizations. We think that they will be more accountable and more responsible for their actions once they know that people in their congregation can sue the religious organizations and can take all of their actions for their own support. Thirdly, they've had this point about how the environment is also responsible for you being of a certain religion and how your parents maybe are also responsible that kind of harm was inflicted upon you because, well, they Christianed you when you were born. And we have, and this is where, no thank you, this is not where I'm going into the main distinction I want to make this in this debate. I can be a Christian, I can believe in the Christian God and not agree and not be okay with the kind of treatment that my local, no thank you, Catholic or Orthodox church applies to me. I can believe in the love of the people around me, in kindness and no thank you, and all of the other values that Christianity promotes without necessarily being able, without necessarily agreeing with the kind of treatment that priests around me perpetrate and the local religious organizations, the harm that the religious organizations inflicts upon individuals. It's my freedom of exercising religion, and just because I don't agree with some practices, I shouldn't be, no thank you, my only solution shouldn't be opting out, because it's my religion too. And if I want to believe in that religion, and if I want to go to church and so on, I shouldn't be forced to withstand abuse or just drop out because that's the only solution I have. Sure, Beth.
So would you then say that the government should not actively go in and infringe and choose what these churches should do? Go in and make changes in these churches' beliefs when you have the opportunity of banning abortions. Should the governments now change beliefs within churches?
By no means. We're not supporting government action against these kind of religious organizations. We say that individuals who suffer harm from these religious organizations should be able to have a say and change something by suing that religion. This is a major distinction, but at no point in this debate have we said that governments are going to be allowed to barge in on religious organizations. The second point I want to make is that, no thank you, you can sue in a court of justice and then see if that religious organization is found guilty. That's what justice means. We're just arguing here for your right to sue that religious organization. You can go to a court and say, here is what I believe. I've suffered harm, serious harm from the local Orthodox church in my village. And the judge in that particular court and the people responsible for it are going to evaluate your claim. This is what this motion stands for, my right to do exactly that, my right to go in front of that court and say what my claim is and the right to have it evaluated in a proper manner. Before I move on, wouldn't you agree?
So would you then say that there's going to be no change at all cost when you do this? Is your proposal at all going to bring change to these religions?
We do believe it is going to bring change because what these religious organizations rely on is the support of the people. At the moment in which there are more and more complaints about the kind of treatment they apply, about the kind of practices they have in their congregations, we do believe that officials are going to start taking this more seriously because otherwise they would lose credibility, they would lose followers, and so on. We do believe that this is an instrument that would allow for change. And that's exactly what our third argument presented by our second speaker explained. We explain how this will incentivize changing views of the religion that isn't going to be allowed to just sit in its very, very conservative faction anymore because it's going to be held accountable. Lastly, I would like to just take a case study and in order to just evaluate their claim about one individual actually being responsible in all of the cases. Let's take the Orthodox Church of Romania, and more specifically, an Orthodox church in the village I live in. Right nearby Bucharest, I go to church every Sunday, but I'm a homosexual person. How does that church treat me? Well, the entire organization has agreed upon the fact that I should not be able to attend Mass on Sundays, that I should be discriminated against because I'm a homosexual. What do I do? What do I do then? There's no one person I can blame for this treatment. It is my church and my religious organizations that holds this view. At that moment, I should be able to go to a court of justice. Another example, a major problem in Romania, for instance, in the Orthodox Church, is the abuse of the funds of the church. I should be able to attack the religious practice of just gathering funds from religious followers and investing them unwisely and abusively into the kind of projects I do not agree with. I should be able to take need that kind of practice to work, because at this moment, there's nobody evaluating the way the funds of this local church of mine are being spent and are being used on a daily basis. So because we see that in most of the examples we've brought to you today, we're talking about a religious practice agreed upon at a very at a larger level than just one individual, their point about suing only one person doesn't stand. And about the only example they've given us of that particular priest raping a child and being prosecuted on his own, we do agree that he should be the one prosecuted. But if the religious organization takes part in a cover-up and just hides the action of that priest in order for him not to be sued and not to go in front of a court of justice, we do believe that it's the fault of the religious organization. I should be able to sue the Catholic Church because they were part of a cover-up of me being raped when I was a child and I had nothing to do. They did nothing in order for that priest to be prosecuted and just excommunicated from the church. For all these reasons, because we do have legitimate claim and need for such a measure right now, we beg of you to propose the motion. Thank you.
Now we will hear from the third opposition speaker.
Mr. Speaker, today we've seen a SAVA proposition that has failed to explain why it is that you have to fulfill all requirements of a religion in order for you to be to belong to this religion. They failed to explain to you why it is that because a church or a priest or whatever religious figure advises you not to get an abortion, not to get a blood transfusion, then that will lead to you not getting it, and that is that priest's fault. They have not explained to you why, and furthermore, why this is true, and they have not explained to you why they are going to change anything under their model, and that's why we essentially believe that we've taken this debate today. So, before getting in, today I have identified three clashes. Firstly, the effectiveness, secondly, legitimacy, and thirdly, freedom of choice. So straight into the first clash about effectiveness. So they essentially started out by saying that when you're not allowed to get abortion because you live in, for instance, a Catholic country or a country where you're advised not to get an abortion, then that will lead to you not, or if you live in a country where abortion is not legal because it is a Catholic country or a Muslim country or whatever, then that will improve when you're allowed to sue the Catholic Church. So essentially say that if you live in such a fundamentalist country that they've banned abortion for religious reasons, then you suing the Catholic Church or the Islamic Church will not change, don't think you, anything at all, because these governments are so fundamentalist, because they don't, because you're saying, because you're suing the religious church for not having the right to abortion, then that will not change anything at all. We have not seen the connection in this argument. Secondly, They said that, we don't disagree with the fact that of course you should have the right to abortion within a country, but we don't believe that we've seen like a mechanism as to why that like then this would stop. We did see some explanation from the last speaker about how like because people stop supporting the church because they now start suing the church, then that will lead to like a change little by little because like you sue these religious institutions, then they will lose their power and eventually you will get the right to abortion. So essentially, we don't believe that because a couple of people start suing the Catholic Church because they don't have the right to abortion will lead to the Catholic Church losing power. They fail to recognize how much power a Catholic, the Catholic Church and these institutions actually have, how much money they have, how much support they have worldwide. Just because a few people or even like a few thousand people start suing the Catholic Church, the Islamic Church, this will not lead to the Catholic Church losing support. What it will lead to is more polarization, more religious conflict, and we believe that they fail on that point. However, no thank you, on our side, we have proven to you in Andrea's third point how this will actually lead to backlash. Because when people start suing the Catholic Church because they don't have the right to, for instance, abortions, to, for instance, girls to go to school, in like the Islamic world, then that will just lead to people feeling like their specific religion is being targeted for something, and that will lead to them being, no thank you, more provoked, more like thinking, feeling like their religion is being targeted, and is like that they are being blamed for harm that has come to some specific people. So we say that because religion is such a sensitive topic, this will lead to people starting to believe that this will lead to more polarization because they start feeling that their religion is being blamed. And because religion is so personal and so sensitive, then this will lead to more conflict in the long term. To the second clash about legitimacy. So essentially they said that the religious institution is responsible for you choosing, for instance, not to get a blood transfusion if your local church tells you you shouldn't get this, it's against your religion. Essentially, we say that no, this is not the religion's fault. It's not the religion's fault if you choose not to get the blood transfusion. You still have, no thank you, a free choice. You still have a choice to choose that you don't want to, in a moment, that you don't want to abide to this. We believe that it's the religious institution's responsibility to guide you within the religious, within the religious guidelines. So we believe that it is the religion's responsibility to say, in this religion, it's not a good idea to get a blood transfusion. And then it's your free choice to say, do I want to abide to this religion or do I not? That's your free choice, and you have to deal with the consequences of this religious choice that you either choose to make or not to make. This is not the religion's responsibility, and for that reason, it's not legitimized to sue the religion for you making that choice, but you disagree.
It's not necessarily that you won't go to a blood transfusion because your religion tells you to. It's that once you do that blood transfusion, your religious organization is going to shun you and going to harm you psychologically and not allow you to go to their masses and betray your trust in that sense. You should be able to sue them then because they cannot allow you to manifest
religion. I understand your point. But then again, if you make that choice, if you make the choice not to get the blood transfusion, then you would know that that was the consequences. And of course, if you abide to this religion in the first place where you know that blood transfusion is not allowed, but you know that abortion is not allowed, then you should also consider those consequences before joining that religion, so we don't believe that point stands either. Okay, so essentially I believe that I now, I also brought this up, this legitimacy point up in a POI, which was also our case that we presented to you today. So we, about how it is, about whether or not it's the entire church's responsibility if one person within this church does something wrong, for instance, molesting a child, for instance, other harms that could occur, like not allowing gays to marry, or condemning gays in general. So we say that because we don't believe that all the time one person is representative for the entire religion or the entire church, it's not legitimized to sue an entire church if it is only one person, two person within this church that has actually done the harm to you. We believe that in most cases this will actually be the case, that it is only one person or two person within this religion and that it is their responsibility. So we don't see that it's legitimized to sue an entire church and also condemning perhaps even an entire religion, which in many cases will be the signal that you send when when you say we don't believe this, like that it's fair that you don't deny us the right to abortion, we'll be like condemning or blaming like one entire religion. Moving on to the last clash about the freedom of choice. So essentially, I believe that in many aspects, I've already dealt with this. Because all, like, because what they brought to us was that you don't have the freedom of choice because you, as was just pointed out in POI, because you are afraid of like being condemned if you get this blood transfusion or abortion. Well, we say that still, like, you have the freedom of choice. You have the freedom to decide whether or not, in the first place, you want to be a part of religion that of a religion that has these ideals, that has these beliefs. So that is, in the first place, your freedom of choice. We also say that the government, that if we believe that there is a religion that has a certain impact, like a certain degree of manipulation, a certain degree of brainwash, then that is something that we would, like, as a government have to deal with. This was what Clara talked to you about in the first argument, that if we have a religion that is so severely harmful, so severely manipulating, then that is like then that is the government, something the government has to deal with, and also mainly something that is like due to your social heritage, due to your social background, and not something that you should blame on the religion, because it's not the religion's fault that you are easy to manipulate. So for all these reasons, I beg you to oppose.
We will now hear the reply from the opposition.
Three questions for today's reply. Firstly, whose responsibility is it? Secondly, is it effective? And thirdly, who protects the people from the religion's better? So let's go into like and look at whose responsibility it is. They told us that we have to sue the organizations because they're the ones who are doing it wrong. Essentially, we've been telling you, if the religion's organizations are the ones who have been doing wrong, the religions themselves are the ones who have been imposing those requirements on the people, which they don't like in the first place. So why don't you just sue the religions in the first place as a whole, and then doing it like as a religious institutions? Now, that might not be possible, but we think that they maybe should crack down on religions, because that's their stance in today's debate. They don't like the requirements of religions as a whole. The religions organizations is an extension of that. But secondly, we say even if we believe that religions organizations like harms one, they also believe that they harm like everybody who takes part, right? So we say that therefore it's the state's responsibility to take care of it, because the state's responsibility is to protect the people in the first place from being harmed as a whole. So we're saying that if the individual is being harmed, that means they can go sue. But because they are telling us that it's not only the individual, but that everybody who can't get an abortion, everybody who's being harmed the same way, then the state should like prevent the religions from doing that in the first place, right? So ladies and gentlemen, what did we tell you today? We told you that first of all, it was the state's responsibility, because according to them, they harm like everyone, right, within that certain religion. But secondly, we say that the individual can sue the other individuals that have been directly harming them, right? They basically said, we agree. But thirdly, we say even if the religion is responsible, right, and it's their responsibility, we say that the individual consented to it in the first place, saying, I want to be a part of this religion. But we say, on the other hand, they don't have to fulfill all the requirements to be a good religious person. They simply never dealt with that. Me as a Christian, I don't have to fulfill all the requirements, right? They essentially never dealt with that, and why it's so important to fulfill all requirements, right? If I really want an abortion, I can go get an abortion. That doesn't mean I'm like a bad religious person, right? We think that I've never really dealt with that. And on that basis alone, we already think they lost the debate. But let me look in the second class. Is their model at all effective, right? They basically made this assumption that if I go sue a religious organization, it's going to succeed. We basically have multiple responses, right? Firstly, we told you over and over again that most of the countries that's going on, the government takes a clear stance within religion. This means most of these Middle Eastern countries and African countries are not going to give them any rights because themselves had to take a stance within religion. Secondly, they told us that most of these cases also go on in Western liberal democracies where there is a separation of church and state. Right, we may agree that they go on like in Western liberal democracies. But ladies and gentlemen, they have ignored all of our analysis as to why it's still not going to do anything. Because one, the religious organizations have got the money to hire good lawyers and stuff, right? We see that plays a big role in today's society, even within the justice system. Clara brought this point up in her very first speech. Throughout all of their speeches, they actually never dealt with that. But secondly, we tell you that they don't have the power as an individual human being, right? But thirdly, we tell you that they don't change anything for the other ones in the religion, right? If they really want to change the circumstances for every religious person, maybe they should agree with us that the state should be doing it, right? So essentially under their logic, right, the state agreed to the state doing it. Third and final clash, who protects the people better, right? We told you firstly they haven't given any mechanisms. But secondly, they haven't really responded to our third and final argument about how we're going to create a backlash because the government essentially tells people that your religion is wrong, right? Ladies and gentlemen, I'll post with us today. Thank you.
Alright, and now we will hear the reply from the proposition.
I'm Christian. I believe in love. I believe in tolerance. I believe in kindness. I believe in the true Christian values. Yet one day, I get really sick. I get a rare blood disease that requires a blood transfusion. I go to the church near my house where I go every Sunday to pray with my fellow Christians. I ask, Father, what should I do? What does the church think about this? Should I get a blood transfusion? The father says, no, because the religion organization is against it. We do not support it. It's a sin. You will no longer be a true Christian if you do it. Now, this is where it gets tricky, because I will essentially have a big dilemma, which will be extremely traumatizing for me at this moment. Because on one hand, I know I need it for my health. I know it's necessary for me in order to live. Yet on the other hand, I know that apparently my church, something that's so personal and close to me, is against it. So what should I do? I have essentially three options. I can either do nothing about it, which is what happens now, and endure the terrible pain of knowing that I need something, yet I cannot get it because my emotional connection to that religion prohibits it. And that's extremely problematic for these people. Option two, I can opt out of the church, which is also extremely problematic. Why? I don't want to opt out. I want to be Christian. I don't want to abandon my religion. I still believe in the same values. I don't have to abandon something that's so important to me just because this local institution tells me that I'm no longer a Christian because I do it. I know in my heart that God is not about blood transfusion, that God is about something else that I want to have access to every other Sunday, that I can pray freely because I know that this is what God is about. Yet the third option, which we defend today, is to sue the religion organization, this local body that told me that apparently it's a sin to get healthy if I need it. And what does that bring? First of all, it brings closure. I can finally get what's right. And if the judge decides that I'm not right, then that is still okay. Because I get to go in front of somebody and complain about something that I know has been wrong. I get to tell somebody what I don't like about this religion institution. I get to have a say, something that I haven't before. Every other day, I go there and I listen to what the father tells me. I listen to him preaching, yet now I get to say something. And what team opposition has essentially told us that you can only sue somebody when you have been harmed without your consent. And this problem with consent is something that we have been debating about today. What is consent? Now, we've been telling you that this consent is not like any other consent that we give. It's not like when I enter a religious institution, when I choose to become Christian or Muslim or Buddhist, I sign a contract. It's not like I'm presented the pros and cons, the obligations, the duties, the rights. It's not like I sign to agree with everything that the church says. It's not like I fully give my consent to it. Why? Because I'm emotionally invested in my religion. Religion is about relating to somebody without involving the rational process. I can still believe in those values, yet be torn apart by policies that are not related to this religion. We believe that if you look at imagine all the gay people that cannot enter the church because they feel like people will judge them. Look at all the women that have to bear pregnancies that affect their health because they are afraid that the priest will tell them that it's a sin. Think of all the families that cannot bury their loved ones because they committed suicide. These people need to be able to say that religion is not about these practices, that religion is about much more than that, and that they should have the power to protest against it in a court of law. Thank you.